This broadcast is being heard over the networks of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation and of the Broadcasting Corporation of Newfoundland, so that the people of both countries may have an immediate impression of the event.
We have reached an agreement for the entry of Newfoundland as a province of Canada. The agreement is now to be signed.
I think you could hear the actual sound of the pen upon the paper.
Mr. Smallwood?
The sound of Mr. Smallwood's vigorous signature. And now the second copy.
Let's give three dusty cheers for Newfoundland. Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray! Tiger, hooray!
That call for the cheer was from the Prime Minister, Mr. Saint-Alain. People are coming down from the chairs and congratulating the main characters in today's formal act, which was the signing of the agreed terms for the Union of Canada and Newfoundland. The signatories were members of a delegation from Newfoundland and representatives of the Canadian government.
The island dominion of Newfoundland, Britain's oldest colony, considers its future. A hardy island people, Newfoundlanders have lived off the cruel North Atlantic for centuries. A cruel sea, but one of great bounty. In the early 1930s, the tranquility of the island is rocked by political and economic instability coming out of the World Depression. In the turmoil, agitators provoke mobs of hungry and desperate men. Anarchy reigns in the streets of the capital, St. John's. Finally, in 1933, the government collapses. The result? Suspension of representative government and administration of the island by a British commission through the war years. Then, in the great global battle for freedom, Newfoundlanders serve with distinction. The Newfs put out the welcome mat for the Yanks, who establish several air and naval bases. Now, with the return of peace and prosperity, it's time to think of the future. In every isolated community, in every bay and cove, Newfoundlanders are discussing the most important political decision of their lives. Representatives are elected and sent to St. John's for a national convention of Newfoundlanders. Joseph Smallwood from Bonavista advocates union with Canada under the Confederate banner. Peter Cashin from St. John's argues for a return to political independence under responsible government. Debate is vigorous. The issue at hand is whether or not Newfoundland will continue to exist as a sovereign state or become a territory within the great neighboring dominion of Canada. A delegation from the convention visits London for talks with the Dominion's office. Here, they are welcomed by Dominion's office official, G. Wilson Hammersmith. Mr. Moon from Twillingate, Mr. Hammersmith, Mr. Vokey from St. John's, Mr. Fudge from Burin. They will discuss terms for the repayment of Great Britain's war debt to Newfoundland in the event that the island returns to independence status. The National Convention ends with a call for referendum. Newfoundlanders will decide between political independence under responsible government or confederation, union with its sister dominion, Canada.
Newfoundland was naive enough to think that they would just be embraced by Canadian society.
The view that the country was being sold to Canada at a discount by the British was pretty widely held.
But Newfoundlanders went for it.
No, I don't think they did.
They did?
Well, no, I think they were just rejecting the earlier manifestation of their state.
The nation rejects its own state?
Yes, in a way, but not exactly.
I don't understand.
Well, maybe they did, maybe they didn't.
What does that mean?
Well, that's what my thesis is about.
Is this some sort of Newfie joke?
We're running quite late now. Thank you very much, Miss Volkey. We'll get back to you.
Is this some sort of Newfie joke? Newfie joke? Those stupid bastards, those stuffy mainland pigs. So typical.
6 months, Frida. You've got 6 months to finish this thing, that's it. A couple of years ago, you made a very convincing case that there was something interesting to be learned from your little country that disappeared.
I was young.
Are you saying that you don't believe any of that anymore?
I believe in it. I am absolutely convinced of it. I've lost the board. I don't know what any of it means anymore. The people, the state, the dominant ideology. What does any of that mean?
Si, bébé, j'ai passé l'après-midi à te chercher, sacrément. Qu'est-ce qui se passe avec toi?
Je suis en train de penser, Denis.
Sacrément, tu penses à quoi?
Had a bad day.
Oh, ben ça, si, voilà. Et tu, on va aller en parler à la maison?
Voici moi l'eau, par exemple.
Et là, je vois de l'argent. OK.
Oups. Ah, musique. Mm-hmm. Oh, OK. OK. Et t'as-tu parlé à Wallet? Oh, ouais, le sacrement. Moi, je vais y parler demain. C'est ça, puis je te rappelle demain. OK, bye-bye.
What do you mean by coming back here? Do you think that's why I gave up my whole goddamn life? So you can come back here with your tail between your legs like some kind of whipped dog or some goddamn thing? What the fuck do you intend to do now?
And this last bit of research is really overdue, and you know.
No, what?
Well, I kind of reached the limit with Denise. You expect too much from him, Frieda.
How can you say that? You know nothing about the situation.
I can say that because women always expect too much of men.
I'm trying to figure out whether that's a feminist statement or not. Hmm. Maybe it is. How's Chris, Mom?
Oh, well, you know Chris.
Well, he's okay, isn't he? I mean, did he ever tell you exactly what happened?
It was just a performance art piece. It was called If a Joke Falls in the Forest, Does Anybody Laugh? So Chris, of course, jumped out through a 27-story window. And you know how lucky Chris is? His parachute didn't quite open. And, well, if he hadn't landed on that taxi... That was 4 or 5 years ago. Of course, you haven't been home.
Don't you tell him to get you back.
No, I'll just take this. I'll go get your father. All right, you go on in.
All right. Is Chris here?
I suppose he is. I don't know.
Chris!
Lester!
Hi, Frieda.
Ah! Oh, Jesus. Oh. Oh, I'm sorry. Does it still hurt?
Not so much.
Not so much. You know how he did that?
What?
He fell off the roof of the house 2 weeks ago.
Is that true?
Ah, how the mighty have fallen.
Oh, look at Mom's two little birds back in the nest. Get your sister a cup of coffee.
Why do you do it, Chris?
Secret.
Well, my dear, what brings you home after all these years?
Came to see you, you old fart. Hello, Dad.
Really?
Actually, I came to do some work. I'm going to try to get to see Smallwood before he dies. I even thought you might be able to help me out,
actually. Smallwood got another century left in him.
Oh.
Yes, they've got a committee of eminent Newfoundlanders set up now to see that his remaining works are published.
Good. I think you mean eminent.
Now, you know that that's leasehold,
that's
not freehold,
right.
So
I
may have a bit of trouble there. Okay, Daddy.
Got to be hard as nails
yes,
to fight it out on the semantic battlefield. Give an inch and soon you won't know what you meant.
Well, I've lost this battle because I don't have a clue what you're talking about.
Jesus, the minute I walk in the door.
Well, Frieda, you needn't pretend to be so sensitive.
See you in the morning.
You're back home now.
Okay.
Dad, look at this. I got this for you. Nice, huh? Look, Mom.
What's that?
Isn't that pretty? Nice frame.
God, the delegation's in London. Look at your father. Look at that sweet face on him. You wouldn't recognize him.
He's nice, eh?
Sure. A goddamn waste of time. Goddamn English bastards.
Don't get him going on Confederation, for God's sake.
No, you've heard enough about that, have you?
Yes, I have. You can't be bitter about it forever. It's done.
Yeah, look at us. Where are we? We're nowhere. Look at you, Mr. New York artist. Do you know what he's been doing since he got back home with his tail between his legs? He's down dispatching taxis.
What is wrong with that?
It's creative.
Wonderful, darling.
It's great.
Well, I got better things to do with my time than to waste of talking to the likes of you.
Jesus, Mom, Dad, some crooked.
Oh, don't mind them, girl. He was born crooked. Oh, look. Poor old Charlie Maddox. God, I still miss him. Yeah, they say he took his own life.
I can understand that.
More questions today about the health of Premier Valentine Aylward and his ability to govern effectively in the face of growing hostility from Ottawa. At his summer retreat in Auk Bay last week, a visibly shaken Premier Aylward refused comment.
How are you feeling today, Mr. Blaine?
Please,
how are you feeling, Mr. Premier?
Please.
Can you confirm dental cranial dysfunction?
We have no comment at this time.
Is it true that the Prime Minister tried to speak to the Premier?
Give us a break, will you, Walsh? Come on, back up. Have some respect.
Now, if you need anything, just call room service.
Thanks, Mom.
I'll be in the bathroom cleaning up.
Okay.
Welcome home, Frida. Lorenza Goodyear.
Of wry humor, their miseries gave the island its names, like Empty Basket, Bleak Island, Breakheart Point. But with tenacious hope, they clung to their barren rocks, calling their settlements by the names of their dreams and their faith. Sweet Bay, Harbor Grace, Heart's Content. St. John's is the island's one city, a city built for trade. Here, schooners from the outports bring their hauls to the merchants of Water Street. Here, dried salt cod, graded and sold by the kentle, becomes the basis of Newfoundland's economy. Fresh cod for the home market is sold in the coves at the ends of the streets.
For a while, that's great.
Well, you know, I spent years not doing this thing, feeling bad about it, not talking about it, thinking, well, I tried and I failed, so shag it, forget it. Who cares, you know, I'll do something else. But now I've given myself 6 months to finish it.
You do it, your brain.
I feel like Nancy Drew, you know, like Carson Drew's my father. Only I think Carson's a bit more supportive of Nancy's career.
So you haven't talked to the old man yet?
The Confederation debate was a nasty, convoluted business, you know, and the old man was there.
I hope you do it. I'd love to see the whole scam exposed.
Me too.
Charles, your sharp eyes have yet to fail me.
Thank you, sir.
Well-known St. John's lawyer, Leo Cryptus, who passed away suddenly at his home this week, will be buried tomorrow. Though never elected to public office, Mr. Cryptus was known as a key advisor to and organizer for Newfoundland liberals. Long known as an accurate vein of political winds, his change in political allegiances is regarded as one of the key factors in the Liberals' loss of power.
Nothing to be done for it.
decay had actually set in years ago.
Straight wrong.
What was the cause of death?
Tuberculosis. Amazing, eh? In this day and age.
Oh, dear.
Sid.
Lester.
Have you met Cecil? Cecil Perkinson? Lester Vokey?
Perkinson.
How do you do?
I think I've heard the name.
I mean, what connection?
I don't remember.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm Michael.
Oh.
Leo's son.
I'm Frida. Frida Vokey. Hello.
Did you know my father?
No. I study Newfoundland history.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Here in St. John's?
No, actually, I study in Montreal.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I'm here with my father.
Of course. Vokey, of course. Yes. Father was fascinated by history, but he seemed, I don't know, unable to reconcile himself to his role in it all. I would love to talk to you about it.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps if we could meet, you could, excuse me.
Things in Montreal.
I can't complain, I suppose. I regret leaving Newfoundland in a way. There's a lot of interesting stuff being published out of here. Daniel Maddox is certainly making a name for himself.
Yes, well, it's all a little trendy, isn't it?
I wouldn't have said.
Too sexy for my taste.
I'm surprised Dan has stayed here, actually.
If he left Newfoundland, he'd turn into a pumpkin. You know the type, Frida. A shining star here in his little provincial outpost. One among many in the big leagues.
British fair play. What a crock of shit. Africa. India.
Frida, a word of warning. Newfoundland is not the best place to study Newfoundland history. And people here have a very proprietary view of the subject.
Well, why shouldn't they? It's their history.
Yes, very much so, but it's still unfolding. People very close to this thing are still alive, you know.
What thing?
100 years of peace.
Excuse me, Dr. Fury.
Corsican tyrant. Suez. Ireland. Palestine. Shakespeare. Marmite. Cold toast.
Get him out of here, for the love of Christ. I can't go. Doreen's a mess.
Come on, Dad.
Come on, Lester. Come on.
The British Navy. Father me.
Take me home, love.
For the love of Jesus, take me home.
Dad, we're home.
Uh-huh.
Dad?
Hmm.
Do you know a Lorenzo Goodyear?
Goodyear? Vaguely. 1940s sometime.
Work for Cashin, I think. I don't recollect. Why?
No reason.
Regret and remorse. Something you almost said to her before she left. A life with someone you could never love. A failed career. They drift skyward as vapor, collecting clouds and fall as rain over Newfoundland, a lonely Avalon in the North Atlantic. The rain becomes the brooks and ponds where solitary trout harbor regrets as they twist and float through the murk. Occasionally, tempted by a shining lure, the trout are caught, and someone is released from the prison of regret. Who decides which trout will be harvested? Who will be released? I am an angler. I have a duty. I go trouting.
Sure you have the stats, darling, don't you? Yes. Yes, hardwood floors throughout. Yeah, and a family room. Push the family room, Ruthie. They're empty nesters, but I can smell youngsters off. Yeah. Okay, darling. All right. Bye-bye. You could help her out, you know.
Oh.
You know exactly what I'm talking about.
No, I don't know exactly what you're talking about.
Lester, have I become sexually invisible? To other men, I mean.
Its primary industry neglected and its credit exhausted. The glowing visions of a new utopia were dispelled with cruel suddenness by the cold realities of national insolvency. Today, a bewildered and disillusioned people, deprived in many parts of the country of all hope of earning a livelihood, are haunted by the grim specters of pauperism and starvation. Politics in Newfoundland.
Jimmy, can you give us a hand, please?
I appreciate this is very short notice.
No, not at all.
Father was a scrupulous archivist. I imagine it's quite a thorough record of his business.
Yes, I'm sure it's fascinating.
Mm-hmm. Yes, fascinating.
Hello, Michael.
Oh.
Thanks.
Miss Wilkie.
Frida.
Frida, yes, sorry. Hard at work, I see.
What are you doing here?
Father's papers. I imagine they might be of some historical interest.
I bet. Mr. Cryptus?
Yes.
Can I get you to sign some papers?
Why, certainly. Well, goodbye.
Bye.
Frida.
Then you better be talking to me, do you understand?
If you shag up another contract with me, you'll be cut along with William Poker and Cathy Lonnie, you hear me?
It is imperative that the source for this information must remain anonymous. Leo Cryptus.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Fine.
Sorry to be late. Took longer than I thought. Sit down.
I just got here myself, actually, Dan. How are you?
Good.
Good. Can't help hearing about you these days. Can't open a journal without seeing your name.
Matter of survival, really.
False modesty. So you enjoy life here on the other side?
As faculty? Yeah. Drink?
Okay.
So you still working on your dissertation?
Just cleaning it up, actually. I really think your work's quite good, Dan. Some of the most interesting stuff to come out of here in ages.
Oh, thanks.
I was wondering if we could get together and discuss it sometime.
Sure. How about dinner at my place?
Okay.
Great.
No wonder you're cracking up the way you hang around this place.
Frida, give me a break. I survived a 27-story plunge into the streets of Manhattan.
All the more reason, Chris, why you should get off your arse and get back to your work.
My career is ruined. I'll never work in New York again.
Fuck New York. You never had a good word to say about the place anyway.
What am I supposed to do? Work here?
Why not? Aren't the buildings tall enough?
Why don't you work here? There's work to be done. So you got a date tonight, huh? Who is it?
Mind your own business, Chris.
Look, if the lady's in a wheelchair, you put her packages in the trunk. That's the policy.
Crown. By the way, who's up in Rabbit Town?
21's up there.
21?
Yeah, I'm here.
21, 17 Grave Street.
Shag it. Let someone else take it. I'm going home out of it.
12, 17 Grave Street. What's wrong, 21?
Nothing.
That's a crock.
Who asked you, 16?
21, I believe everyone has noticed something, and I think they're kind of worried. Crown. By the way, who's near the stand?
9 here. We'll take it.
9, the ship in. Do you want to talk about it, 21?
Oh, you want to know, do you? Well, everyone knows anyway. 32's been sleeping with Judy.
32 here? That's lies.
Don't try and deny you've been going out with Judy, 32.
Oh, I knows it.
32, I believe 21 deserves some honesty.
I'm not going to be getting guilty about it, right?
Sure, he threw her out.
Right, you knows I'm always throwing her out. You're cracked, 32.
21, 32, you're objectifying Judy. I mean, don't her feelings count in all this?
Good question.
He's throwing her out all the time, not because of the way he feels towards her, but because he's disgusted and ashamed of himself, right?
21, 10's got a point there. I mean, you do have a poor self-image. You should try to develop a more positive outlook.
What kind of self-image would you have if 32 was sleeping with your missus?
Well,
Is he a good dispatcher?
Fine as kind. Got a problem?
He'll be making some progress anyway,
Yeah.
Want to talk to him?
No, maybe some other time.
Anyone there to strip?
This is it.
Pair 6.
Thank you.
Pair 6 to Waterford.
How much is it?
$320.
Here, that's okay.
Oh, thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Who's in the West End?
Have a nice night, eh?
Okay. Take care. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Hungry?
Starved. Oh, my God. Wow.
Wine?
Thank you. Wow, look at the caviar. Mm-hmm. That's amazing.
Oh, it's nothing.
Thanks.
To us.
Starving. It's amazing.
It was good.
Tu es vraiment gastronome.
Oh, merci. So, we were going to talk about your work, Frida.
We were, but it doesn't seem appropriate now.
No? Okay, what do you want to talk about?
How about you?
Oh, how about you?
I asked first.
I'm sure you know everything about me.
You think so?
Go ahead, try.
Okay. Not a name, St. John's family, but fair Catholic stock. Upwardly mobile, middle class, ambitious. Your grandfather ran the general store in Fairyland. Ooh, that is to say, doing well, but still shunned by the old money crowd who are mostly Protestants.
Okay, go on.
Okay, the academic son to go along with your brother Des, who's a lawyer.
Patty's a doctor.
That's right, all Patties are doctors, all doctors are Patties. And, well, there should be a priest in there, but nobody's perfect.
Well, I was in the seminary for a while.
And you're ultimately supposed to be a big wig in the university administration, being a native son. And you're up there charming the pants off co-eds with your grasp of the dusty past.
Jesus, you're very thorough. But you got a file on me or what?
Well, our fathers were both in the National Convention.
Makes us almost twins. Confederation babies.
Yeah. And your father was...
Died in 67. Cancer.
Right.
I don't have the wealth of insider information that you do with your father.
Oh, my father doesn't talk about it. He wrote about politics and has for years, but has never written about Confederation. And he's still got a lot of bitterness, especially towards the British.
Lester ever talk about my father?
No.
Now, that's strange. I mean, they were allies. Partisans, if you like.
Well, I don't think they knew each other that well. And my father never liked townies that much, especially ambitious Catholic townies, although he married one.
You should have been one yourself. How come you didn't go to Holy Heart?
Well, there was a little lapse there. I mean, I never even met my maternal grandmother. She rejected my mother when she married my father. And, by the way, they got married in the courthouse, so that was it. Ooh, vodka.
Piece de resistance. You?
Yeah. I'll have a drink, too.
To Newfoundland?
Newfoundland's confederation with Canada, part two.
We are never surprised, certainly never shocked, when we learn that we have one of the highest.
Are you kidding?
One of the highest infant mortality rates in the world. One of the highest maternity mortality rates in the world. One of the highest rates of beriberi and rickets in the world. We take these shocking facts for granted. We take for granted our lower standards, our poverty. We are not indignant about them. We save our indignation for those who publish such facts.
Dear Mr. Mill,
Cathy. Regarding your request of June 1st, 1989, please find attached a record of checks issued to the Dominion's Office of the Government of Newfoundland between January 1st, 1946.
Our people are no longer in the mood to bow down and almost
worship a man. Dear Dan, thank you very much, you treacherous prick. It's not enough you screw me in the flesh, but you gotta screw me in print, too. Maybe I'm mistaken about some of my ideas showing up under your name in the Journal of Modern History. Ooh, damn. Dear Mr. Maddox, I regret to inform you of your request for a declassification tribunal regarding file DO31 blah 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 from the Public Records Office. But these files are retained by the Foreign Office under the Official Secrets Act. Dear Mr. Maddox, I'm afraid I can't be of any assistance as to your inquiry as to the contents of two files concerning Newfoundland affairs. It is my understanding that an appeals tribunal can... I must say, I view as criminally irresponsible your veiled suggestion that the final referendum results may have been tampered with by British Dominion's officials. As I'm sure you're aware, Leo Cryptas scrutinized the final vote tabulation on behalf of the National Convention. Mr. Cryptas is a gentleman of unimpeachable honor and reputation. Such accusations on your part could have incalculable political consequences. G. Wilson Hammersmith.
Much in particular, the attractive bait which will be held out to lure our country into the Canadian host trap. Listen to the flowery steps talk.
The people are going to know the truth. They are not going to be smothered with the lies and propaganda of 1869.
Hi, Chris. I heard you on the car radio today.
No rest for the weary.
You were good.
So did you have a good time with Dan?
How'd you know about that? St. John's really is a little village, isn't it? Dan Maddox, little bastard. He's years ahead of me, Chris. And the stuff he's got. I'd like to kill him. Good cook, though.
Oh, no. Mr. Cryptas was acting as legal counsel for the British Dominion's office at the time, and as such was neutral.
Well, he was supposed to be neutral, but I think that everybody recognizes that the British were very strong supporters of the Confederation option.
Ms. Vokey?
The future of Newfoundland was decided within a very short period of time. It was only 3 years from the calling of a national convention through the whole debate to the referenda in which we apparently renounced our independence and ended up as part of Canada.
What do you mean by apparently?
Well, I mean apparently because I'm not so sure what happened exactly. It's a pity we couldn't ask Mr. Cryptus.
I'm sure Miss Vokey is referring again to rumors of British and Canadian interference with the political process at the time. Rumors which, by the way, I consider to be totally unfounded.
Now, Miss Vokey, you're in the lucky position of having a father who was a member of the convention, Lester Vokey. He must be a great help to you in your work.
Oh, yes. He could be a great, tremendous help.
All right. I want to thank you all very much for coming in. Dr. Dan Maddox, Dr. Sidney Fury, two professors at Memorial University, and Frida Vokey, a doctoral student from Montreal.
Thank you.
Frida?
I'm in a hurry.
About last night.
Later, Dan, okay? Call me later. I really am very busy right now.
Hi. Fancy meeting you here.
That's a coincidence, isn't it? I'm sorry if I mean,
oh,
did I didn't mean
he's
to.
He's just a professional acquaintance. So you're still in town?
For a while, yeah. Father's will, you know? Do you mind if I walk with you?
No.
I have a confession to make.
What?
I was listening to the radio and I knew that you were here.
Really? So what do you know about all this stuff?
What stuff?
Confederation, the referendum, all that.
I thought it was all a dead issue, that stuff from years ago. People still seem a bit sensitive about it. So you like these little alleys?
Oh, this is an art gallery, actually.
Excuse
me. How could I get to see Smallwood, I wonder?
Go see Parkinson, the lawyer. He'll get you in.
Okay.
Well,
I gotta be in.
Me too.
See you later.
Yeah. I'll call you.
All right.
Oh, you were good on the radio this morning, darling. On most questions, but you sounded edgy.
I was. You know what I'd really like to do? I'd love to talk to Dad about all this, Mom.
Well, why don't you just sit down and talk to him about it?
Easier said than done.
Hmm. Not bad for local.
Mom. Mom, do you know Michael Cryptus, Leo's son?
Well, I used to. God, he was a sweet young man, you know, Frida. Not like his father at all, more like Doreen's crowd.
A sensitive type might be nice for a change.
Mm.
I'm pretty sure he's got something I need.
Frida Vokey.
Information, Mom.
Oh, right. Well, you're pretty excited about something, all right? I'll tell you, I like you much better like this. Oh, you used to be so self-important, so right all the time. I can't tell you how aggravating it was. Now, darling, don't get that hurt look. I like you more and more all the time. Of course, you're a little bit shell-shocked now from having just discovered that you don't know it all.
Hmm.
But we'll give you the chance to start right in again from zero. And of course, have your mother there to help you along the way.
It's a great comfort to me, girl.
Oh, yes.
I feel like I'm taking a test. I hope I don't fail.
Oh, I hope not.
You certainly seem to have the credentials. Now, you understand why the Smallwood family has me screen persons such as yourself.
Yes, I understand. Mr. Smallwood's not in very good health.
Exactly. Now, what is this thesis of yours all about?
The decline of the notion of the sovereign Newfoundland state. I'm investigating how a people with national status became so quickly integrated into Canada.
It's not another one of these conspiracy theories, is it? Another unsubstantiated claim that the Confederation referendum was rigged or fixed?
No. The vote itself is not the focus of my work.
If not the focus, what then?
Well, it's significant, of course, in that the Confederation option received a majority of less than 2 percentage points.
Why now is that significant?
Well, I've always found it strange that with 48% of the people opposed to the idea, that nothing more was said about it. Don't you think it's extremely strange that in the 20th century...
I think I may have heard these arguments. Perhaps those voting for independence quickly recognized their error. In any event, the papists and crackpots lost.
I must caution you about painting too flattering a picture of Newfoundland and Newfoundlanders. Well, it is difficult for you because it is, after all, your heritage. Newfoundland is a sad, sad place. Newfoundlanders are a sad, simple people. I'm sure you see them as victims awaiting some kind of emancipation, some kind of heroic revolutionary gesture. Alas, they were just not made for it. What you have in Canada is far better than your lot. What was it Mr. Smallwood said? The sport of historic misfortune, the Cinderella of empire.
Right. And Confederation, the glass slipper.
Yes. Well, I suppose that's clever. Shall I make arrangements for a 7:30 visit?
That would be fine. Thank you, Mr. Parkinson.
That's right. Give my regards to your father.
Thank you.
Mr. Fudge claimed that the attack on Mr. Butt only reinforced further evidence of the Confederates having access to responsible government league secrets. Mr. Cashin asked what was meant by such a statement. Mr. Fudge stated his belief that this could only mean there was a Confederate informant in our midst. Miss L. Goodyear, Secretary, Responsible Government League.
It's just homegrown. Don't worry. I got a couple more if it doesn't work. It's freezing here now, eh?
Yeah. Jess asked me to marry him when I told him about the baby, right? And I just had to, like, bite myself really hard. Because, I mean, I don't know, here we are, like, crumbling. And here it is, you know, Newfoundland. But, of course, that's not your problem up in Montreal. I suppose you're beating him off with sticks.
Definitely. I spent the last 2 years with Denis, just Denis, just me and Denis.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
What's he like?
Oh, serious.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought he was fun, but he's very serious.
What does he do?
He's a salesman.
That's okay.
I met a nice guy here, though.
Yeah? You never told me about that.
His name's Michael Cryptus.
Where'd you meet him?
I met him at his father's wake.
You're kidding. What a place to meet a guy.
He's nice, though, really nice.
Yeah.
He doesn't live here. He's a lawyer. Mm. He left, like me, you know, years ago. Mm. Of course, I would get involved with the mainland as soon as I get here. But the old crowd doesn't exactly seem warm towards me.
I don't mind them. They're probably, you know, like, suspicious. You know, it's like they probably think you're down or getting the last bit of Newfoundland you need to nail down your mainland credentials.
You had two calls, Michael Cryptus and Dan Maddox.
Two men.
Tell me, Rita, would it be all right if you slept with somebody while you were here? Would that be all right with Denis if you slept with, say...
Mom.
God's sake, all right, never mind. The old system of sin and guilt was a lot simpler. At least you knew where you stood.
You should have brought me up Catholic.
Good morning, Dad.
What's the point, I wonder?
What's the point of what?
Could have me call them again.
Well, what is it they're cutting all the time?
You should know. You're a historian.
Well, I don't, Dad. Maybe I'm just ignorant, but I don't.
Forget it.
Don't you believe in what you're doing?
Of course not. Don't tell me you believe in what you're doing.
Don't go starting on her this morning, Lester.
Well, I like to believe I believe in what I'm doing just so I can fool myself into having a sense of purpose, just so I won't end up as crooked as you.
Rita, it's for you. It's that man again.
Thank you. Hello? Hello, Michael. Yeah? Well, I have to drop by the archives, but after that, sure.
Great.
Great, yeah.
All right.
Sounds promising.
All right, thanks. Thank you. Okay, bye. You're perverse.
What do we do?
Get your own sex lives.
Sex lives? You're not planning on having sex with this fellow, are you?
Jesus, no. There's nothing sexual about it.
Then why did you say that about our sex lives?
Because I could tell that's what you were thinking.
I wasn't thinking that at all, were you?
Oh, no, darling, I wasn't thinking that.
I'm aware that people considered him a bit of a political monster, but I never had any real connection to that.
So you're suddenly worried about your father's role in all this?
Does that make sense? Toward the end, I had the feeling he wanted to tell me something. He would start, and then he'd look at me, and remember that I had never cared, that I was ashamed of Newfoundland, which I was. That I left as quickly as I could, became a Canadian, and then he'd clam up.
Sounds familiar.
What was he trying to tell me?
I can't say it now because I don't know what it is. But something is happening around me. I don't know if I have any control over it, but I may be able to tell you.
Oh,
someday.
Frida, forgive me. I have some visitors. Could you please leave out the back door, please?
Oh, sure. Okay.
And take this.
Why?
For your book.
What book?
Few years, but
Hi, Frida.
Hi. Why did you call me this morning?
Just to chat?
Yes, I'm sure. Well, I haven't got a lot of time.
You went through my stuff the other night.
I went through your food and through your bed. You didn't seem to mind that.
You fucked me to get up my papers.
You're a pig, Dan. Wasn't it the other way around?
What'd you find out?
What you already knew and weren't about to tell me about what's probably in there. Saving it for one of your famous articles, Dan? I have a lot of work to do.
Fine.
Do you miss Montreal?
Oh, I'm ambivalent, really. I don't really care where I find myself these days. I was reluctant to come back to Newfoundland. Now that I'm here, I might as well be anywhere.
And what about Denis?
Well, he might as well be anyone.
So that's not working out either.
There was really no proper cataloging. And God only knows what half of this stuff is. Do you have any idea what it is you're looking for?
No, not entirely.
Well, I guess I better go back to the office.
Okay, thanks, Dad. Dad, have you ever heard talk of a British informant?
What?
You know, a spy in the independence camp here during the referendum campaign?
Anything's possible, I suppose. There were strange times. It was a difficult issue.
Say he's ill.
Oh, God. He looks desperate. Why isn't this stuff in the papers?
I don't know.
Out of respect for the family, perhaps. But it's not without precedent.
What do you mean? He's been here before?
No. But it's just when premiers have been ill. I mean, Pickford, Moon.
But who were those men?
Aides, I guess. I recognize the deputy assistant press secretary. They've got a huge staff.
Using the word frog in the vehicles.
My chips yet. It's so nice.
Thank you.
It's so nice.
Yeah, okay, thanks.
I love you.
Okay.
okay.
She's so nice. I love her.
Here. Go ahead. I can't eat now. I feel too sick.
No, this is your... I have one.
Okay.
I have two.
Okay.
I have one more.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay.
You got a bit of fish?
Yeah, you can have the fish. Thanks. I don't want the fish.
You good chief. Thanks.
Fish.
Thanks.
Leave him alone now.
Okay.
Okay.
Some knife. I love her.
Mr. Smallwood, you campaigned for Confederation with Canada using nationalist rhetoric. Wasn't that a fundamental contradiction in terms? Since, in fact, you could have been seen as working against independence and self-determination for Newfoundland?
No. Due to the unique Canadian federal structure, provincial autonomy over key issues can be perceived as an acceptably transformed retention of national status. We retained a national character while realizing enormous benefits, material and immediate, from Confederation.
He said that?
Essentially.
Mr. Smallwood, I'm sure you'd agree that in 1948, most Newfoundlanders felt that eventually union with Canada was inevitable, regardless of the outcome of the referendum.
Mr. Smallwood grudgingly agrees.
Some of your opponents in the debate, Mr. Cashin in particular, felt that better terms of union with Canada could have been negotiated by a free and sovereign Newfoundland state. Isn't that true?
Yes, I felt that. But...
Looking at our current situation in Newfoundland, our resources, fisheries, oil, all owned by Canada, our hydroelectric, stolen by Quebec, our insignificant, almost non-existent voice in the Canadian Federation, the humiliation of mindless make-work projects and transfer payments, the taunting insults of Quebec and the rest of Canada about these things, the practically bankrupt provincial economy, do you think maybe Mr. Cashin was right? Maybe we shouldn't have joined Canada in the way that we did.
The Premier is tired and he's sick and this kind of questioning exhausts him. This will be all. And I hope we've been of some help.
I'll be blind, deaf and dumb, all three, not to understand before this referendum is held. I'll guarantee that right now. All three together, blind, deaf and dumb, not to understand what Confederation means between now and the referendum.
Mr. Smallwood, you cannot proceed. With that peroration of yours.
Mr. Chairman, I bow to your ruling, and I serve notice that the lid is coming off. And on Mr. Hollis, too, where whoever likes it or doesn't like it, this is one time the truth is going to be told. And I'll do it in the proper moment and at the proper time according to the rules of the House. I move that the report lie on the table of the House.
That motion seconded.
colonial building was for 80 years the seat of representative government. Since 1934, and until responsible government is restored, Newfoundland is governed by a commission of six, appointed from London, three Newfoundlanders and three from England.
It is in the best interest of the people of this country. And I repeat that, in the best interest of the people of this country. To affiliate with Great Britain as Northern Ireland is, to affiliate with Timbuktu, Orphans, if it is in the interest of the people of this country, I'm for it, and I support any such motion.
At this very moment, the lines of battle are drawn up, and walking amongst us are those whose burning ambition it is to see this country passed into the hands of strangers. I say to you that there is in operation at the present time a conspiracy to sell, and I use the word sell advisedly, this country to the Dominion of Canada.
Smell funny.
Hi, gorgeous. Ready?
Absolutely. Oh, hold on for a second.
Sure. Yeah? Like Greek?
Love Greek. It's a benefit, actually. Everybody's supposed to go as a character from Newfoundland history.
I think it's a load of old foolishness. Who are you supposed to be?
Archbishop Roach.
You are going straight to hell, my son, isn't he? Mm. Oh, and you are?
I'm Lester Volkey.
Welcome, everybody. As you probably all know, we're here tonight to raise some of the money we lost on the last benefit. It's going to be a long struggle, but I know that we shall overcome. We shall overcome our deficit. And that's because we've set up a benefit finance committee to oversee the work of the benefit accounts committee. And right now, I want to present to you the best band in Newfoundland, the Conquerors.
I'm not properly socialized. I don't know how one behaves in these situations.
You must have been to millions of parties in New York, Chris.
I never went to any parties. It was part of the image I culture. And now I don't take the long road. Quite out of my element at any real event.
Well, look, just have a drink, have a dance, and talk to people.
I can't believe it's that easy, Frida.
Trust me.
What, are you looking for someone?
I was supposed to meet Maggie here. There she is. What are you doing?
Jeez, Fred, I'm not staying here alone.
Hi.
I'm sorry I'm late.
Oh. Wow, you're great.
I see with us.
You know Chris?
Yeah, hi.
Pleased to meet you. That dress is very becoming.
Why, thank you.
Don't overdo it, Chris.
To the company night, we ride together in my conquest against stress. Till I'm with you, oh, it's the only thing that's keeping me true.
Oh my God, Frida, don't look now.
Long road to America, I'll never ride again in vain. But tonight you'll be in my arms, not in my dreams again.
Hello.
I don't think Bob's being responsible. Certainly
yes.
The L-word administration is no longer tenable.
Are you all right?
The latest poll suggests that Finger L-word is still very popular. And
no,
we're talking about a man
they won't print it.
They say it has to be proved.
And who's suffering from a very serious...
All right, then. Come on over.
...of infection in his gums, and the inflammation puts pressure on his brain. Yeah, there are rumors that he's...
7-0, please. Thank you.
Non-Newfoundlanders should be prohibited from creative expression in the Newfoundland voice. I mean, that's such a colonial throwback.
I wonder, though, whether you can deny them the Newfoundland experience.
That is an interesting question, yes, but first we would have to define the Newfoundland experience.
I'm working on that now.
Good! Are you a cultural worker?
No. I'm a jumper, actually.
Hey, Chris! How about a scuff?
Office will say where the fluid came from. But apparently it's being sent to the mainland for analysis.
2 Black Horse, please. Hi, Frida.
Hi, Slutnuts.
That's your problem, Frida.
You're a problem, Dan. What are you doing with Doris?
Just having fun.
I hope you're only trying to get into her pants.
What else would I possibly be interested in?
Play by the rules, Dan. You know the papers are in trust for 50 years.
Well, patience is a virtue, Frida, and you're a virtuous person. I'm sure you can afford to wait. Doris, on the other hand, seems quite impatient. I'm sure you'll excuse me.
Eat my shorts.
Crack me off a piece, why don't you?
We live with a natural alienation caused by our geographic location. On the edge of the oversized nation, outsiders dictate the whole situation.
It's a hard place, Michael.
It's a hard crowd.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I hope I didn't disappoint you, Rita.
No. Why?
My father's papers.
Now it seems that our only resort are desperate young bastards who work cheap. And of course they hit the mainland with our descended hand. And we all understand that this is all planned.
I did what I could to keep them here. Although he stipulated in his will very clearly that he wanted them sent to England, and those two British gentlemen went to the executor who decided to expedite the process.
And?
The two gentlemen you saw at my house.
Yes.
They're from the public records office. On the table! And the papers go to London tomorrow.
Tomorrow? Thanks, Michael.
Sorry.
This unsafe proximity to national monstrosity strains a small and fragile society. Oh, I'm glad my country only comes on TV. Once every 4 years and twice a month in UIC. Dead on the table, you are able to make your voices heard. July 1st, hey, my celebration. I have my own land. I have my own feelings. But the minions of dominions don't give a fuck about our opinions. The minions of dominions don't give a fuck about our opinions, yeah. Give a fuck about our opinions. Then on the table, you are able to make your voices heard. Sit and stop on the common ground. You are the voice that can become the word. Sit on the table, you are able to keep your voices heard.
Sorry, gentlemen, you can't come in here.
Mr. Smallwood seems to have secured the leadership. I would remind your office once again, Mr. Smallwood is an extremely volatile figure. The Dominion's office must make every effort to ensure that Mr. Bradley emerges from all this and most likely can't do for the leadership.
Don't be alarmed.
You're in the building. Oh, my Newfoundland and Admiral Goblin. Do you hear what I say? Get out!
We're from London.
Where are you from?
We're from the Public Records Office in London. Quite all right.
I know you speak the Queen's English.
We're just looking for some
paper. Bitch, a bull to me.
Just looking for some paper.
Get out!
Everything
I know, bitch, I told before.
Get out!
Have
another car.
It'll be quite all right.
Dominion's office. The funds you need will be immediately forthcoming. Let's get to the good stuff.
We're looking for some papers, sir. Don't worry about it.
Do you understand the Queen English?
No problem.
I'll have it on another car.
What in the name of Christ is going on here?
Records office will be getting those papers in good time, but right now they're my responsibility.
We have reason to believe they're being tampered with.
That is ridiculous.
They're not from the public records office.
I think I'm being followed.
There is in operation at the present time a conspiracy to sell, and I use the word sell advisedly, this country to the Dominion of Canada. I repeat, some people may think I am talking wildly, But I would ask them to remember that long before this, I made statements in this house which were regarded at the time as wild prophecies. But time proved that I was right. All I ask you then to do in the present instance is to watch events develop, then pass your judgment on the statements I make today.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there a Merry March? Merry March here? If anybody knows where Merry March is, dress her to please go to the hall office. Merry March.
May I see? The legal implications are staggering. Congratulations. Lose it.
These papers haven't been tampered with. How are you, Dad?
I'm not well. I'm sick.
I listened to the tapes of the convention.
Did you hear Cashin? My God, what a speaker. I say to you that there is in operation at the present time a conspiracy to sell, and I use the word sell advisedly, this country to the Dominion of Canada.
Strange times.
We made a mistake, you know. We were desperate, and we sold the country. Jesus, if you could see the state of the people. The poverty, and the tuberculosis, and the... Jesus, it was desperate. Drunken dreamers, that's all we were. That's all we are.
We were working with the British. It was you.
I was working for Newfoundland. That's the way I saw it. I was working only for Newfoundland.
Years listening to you go on and on, railing on and on about Confederation. But you did it. You did it for money. You sold out your friends. You sold out your country.
No.
Why didn't you tell me? Why did you make me do this?
Because you try so hard not to care, to have an academic interest. Do you have an academic interest in me, in my broken heart? Do you have a way to figure in all the thousands of broken hearts in that perfect little equation you're developing? Did you expect a happy ending? Did you expect me to make it end better? I get a second chance. In my dreams, I get the time back, and you know what? I make the same mistake over and over again. The poverty, the TB, the backwardness of it. Jesus, the people needed some relief. I'd give it all away again tomorrow for one day's relief. Besides, I never cashed the fucking checks.
And the vote was rigged, wasn't it?
Probably. At least that's what we heard. I believed it. But there's no proof.
No proof, eh? Smallwood in on it?
Of course not. She wasn't even meant to be the leader. It was Bradley they wanted for leader. Whatever proof there was now is in the grave with Leo Cryptus. What have you found?
You got questions to answer, old man. What's with the gun, Dad?
There's no bullets in that gun, my love.
Where's Frieda?
Frieda! I need some help.
Oh, no, thank you, Mary. You just sit down right there. There you go, there.
There.
Aren't we the happy family now?
Just break, Dad. We are the happy family.
Well, who's happy here now, I wonder? Are you happy?
On the whole, under the circumstances, I don't feel that bad.
What about you, miracle boy?
Ecstatic, in fact.
Who's surprised at that now, I wonder? Tell me, my son, what makes you so very happy?
I'm surrounded by my family, my lover, lots of people who love one another.
Love one another? Now, who loves who here now, I wonder? Do you love me, Frieda?
Of course I love you, Dad. You're my father.
Do you love your mother as much as you love me?
Easily as much, if not more.
Curiouser and curious.
And Lister, do you love me?
Jesus, Una, love is not the word for it.
No, I bet it isn't.
Well, here we are then. One big, not so unhappy family.
So, who's going to say grace?
I know a Buddhist blessing.
Forget it.
Frida, darling, why don't you say grace?
Mom.
Frida.
Yes, girl. Say grace, for God's sake.
August 12th, 1948, St. John's. Dear Douglas, certainly by now you've heard the results of the referendum, that as we had hoped, the Newfoundland problem will be solved by its integration into the Dominion of Canada. Our long battle will end in victory, and you may guess that I'm in a celebratory mood. But I must tell you that I'm writing you in a condition of great agitation and confusion. I fear I may be an ever silent witness to a most horrible injustice. As you were aware, I was to act as representative of the Crown during the final tabulation of the referendum results. By 3:30 in the morning, it was clear that the Newfoundland people had once again rejected Confederation with Canada. I delivered the final tally sheet signed by three witnesses other than myself to the governor at 4:30 in the morning. I was exhausted and felt quite defeated in my efforts, and proceeded from the governor's residence directly to my home and bed. The next morning, the results were publicly announced, with Confederation with Canada having received a narrow majority of the votes. This result was confirmed by the three gentlemen who had sworn otherwise less than 8 hours earlier. This matter is of such gravity and suggests a conspiracy of such unbelievable extremes that I've remained silent, both out of shock and dismay and fear for my own well-being and that of my family. I tell you this in the greatest confidence, for I no longer know who may be trusted. I will also tell you, my friend, that I retain the original copy of the sworn affidavit as signed by the three witnesses. Quite against my better judgment, I cannot bring myself to destroy this document.
There, that's well taken care of. Just some tidying up, really. Keeping things orderly. I should think that file's retired.
One wonders and one worries that someone might have seen them. Someone might know. It's a grave prospect, and however unlikely, it fills me with a sleepless unease.
I give notice that I will on tomorrow move the following resolution. Whereas it has been brought to the attention of members of this convention that its presiding officer, both in his official capacity...
Now, Mr. Butt, if you'll wait for a moment, please. I have something to say before you.
This could
proceed.
Be the final breath. This is life and death. This is hard rock and water. Out here where the wind has turned and the towers are burning, there is no return.
Slander has been carried on against me by persons whose views I am not in agreement with.
We defy the centuries. We live the oldest of intensities. Laughter and misery. Out here between time and tide, between tears and elation, lies a secret nation. The prayer to which we say amen is written with a poison pen. Hey, yeah.
What does all this mean? In the first place, it means that the British government has endorsed Canada's action, that she has encouraged Canada to give us a big hand. And if she has done this, it also means that the British government is prepared to see us go into Canada, that she wants us to go into Canada. Look out for those amongst us who would take ourselves and our country on a one-way ride.
One, Mr. Chairman, who has confidence in the future of our country and our people. And I do not believe for a moment that this good ship of state is at all leaking. And I am not prepared to send out an SOS for a Canadian rescue tug.
We defy the centuries. We live the oldest of intensities. Laughter and misery. Out here between time and tide, between tears and elation, lies a secret nation. The prayer to which we say amen is written with a poison pen. Hey,
Newfoundland, we're not even a secondary consideration. This is the blunder, Mr. Chairman, which we would try to rectify.
Yes, sir. Our people are in the mood to ask many questions today that they never asked before. And our anti-Confederates are going to find that out in 1948 when the referendum takes place. They will set out to persuade our people that under Confederation, their property will be taxed, their homes, their land, their barns and outhouses, their flakes and stages, their fishing rooms and boats and fishing gear, their animals and livestock. You'll have to pay taxes on all these things, the anti-Confederates will tell you. But the people of Newfoundland needn't bother about this. All this will be fully explained to them, sir, before the referendum is held. They'll have to be blind, deaf, and dumb, all three, not to understand before this referendum is held. I'll guarantee that right now. All three together, blind, deaf, and dumb, not to understand what Confederation means between now and the referendum.
And I will not tolerate any attempt whatever to call my impartiality as chairman into question. Gentlemen, this convention is without a chairman.
You got it planned. You got it planned.